BSHF 101 Unit 25 Human Security. Traversing the path of this course, you have neared the end of your journey and have arrived at the final block, dealing with some contemporary concerns and challenges. This unit, which is the first unit of the last block, takes as its subject the concept of human security. It is a concept of recent origin, as we shall soon see. However, it is derived from concepts which have been in use for a long time and which have addressed some fundamental issues regarding lives of people, issues that have engaged thinkers and policymakers alike. The idea of development, well-being and rights have exercised the minds of writers on social processes and institutions and those concerned with formulating and implementing social welfare policies. Before reading this unit, you would do well to keep in mind or reread, if necessary, the units in block 3 and 5. These blocks are on social system and economic development respectively. Although block 5 primarily deals with Indian economy, you must have got some idea about the functioning of an economy. The present unit explains some fundamental concepts like development, capability and well-being. Once you are acquainted with these ideas, you will be presented with a discussion on the notion of security. We will see how the idea of human security has evolved, drawing from earlier and related ideas of national security and social security, and how it is related to the idea of human rights. What is development? Can it be explained broadly? Can it be explained broadly as the expansion of the capabilities of humans to realize their opportunities and to have the freedom to make choices and lead them to achieve their capabilities? In what ways is the notion of development related to human rights? Does development bring with it an increase in well-being? These questions are discussed in the next section. The subsequent section, which is the central focus of this unit, defines and discusses the concept of human security. It explains the idea of human security, traces its evolution, and tries to relate it to notions of development, well-being and rights. You will see that although echoing in some way the notion of national security, it is very different from it. On the other hand, the idea of social security resonates strongly in human security formulations. The following sections exposits on health and food security. These are crucial and integral components of human security and merit serious attention. Human development and human rights. Human progress encompasses the idea of expanding the choices of people. Ever since the advent of modernity and Renaissance, the idea of progress has nestled in human minds. Along with it, the thought that man is measure of all things has gained ground. The idea that the coming times, the future, can be made better than the past. Due to the Industrial Revolution, first in England and then elsewhere in the West, there was huge increase in the incomes of nations and the standard of living of their people. The people enjoyed unprecedented increase in their purchasing power. And there were spectacular increase in productivity due to adoption of scientific power and new technology and techniques of production. It saw the beginning of the era of what has been called modern economic growth. It was accompanied by increased urbanization and a rise in the proportion of labor force engaged in manufacturing sector, while at the same time a fall in the labor force engaged in agriculture. Over time, the share of agriculture in national product fell substantially, while that of manufacturing increased by leaps and bounds. Later, in the early 20th century, Russia was to transform itself through industrialization-led spectacular economic growth, although it had a completely different economic and political system. It too followed the use of technology to increase industrial productivity and transform its economy through rapid economic growth. These sorts of experiences in different countries lead to the belief that economic growth and increase in national income are the key to success in development and progress. It was later realized that people will use the benefits of growth and development. Human beings are the agents of progress as well as its beneficiaries. They are also ultimately responsible for economic production and growth. We would be making a mistake if we focus only on production and growth as the ends. Expansion in production, rise in incomes, and economic growth are the means. The instruments of development, rise in incomes, is only an intermediate goal. Economic prosperity is only one way to enrich people's lives. Also, there are areas of human lives where economic growth may be ineffective in bringing improvement, like in environmental degradation and ill health. Amartya Sen has put forward an influential approach to development, which he calls the capability approach. The capability approach to development sets human lives as a collection of doings and becomings, which are together called functioning. Functioning denotes the achievement of a person, a person's state of which she is able to do. Capability captures the idea of the collection of various combinations of functioning that a person is able to achieve. The idea reflects a person's freedom to choose between different ways of conducting her life and the various opportunities she gets, the various freedoms she has, and to the extent that she is able to realize her potential. In the course of evolution of the development theories, some thinkers come to argue that human resources were as important in the development process of a nation as material or natural resources. Related to this conception was the idea that a nation can and must invest in human resource in the hope of future returns on investment, in which the same way as investment in any physical or financial asset. Initially, education was considered the quintessential human capital. Later, and as research in development proceeds, health also acquired tremendous importance as human capital. Education and nutritional and health status are important indicators of human development and welfare in their own right. We have seen that people have been considered to be important in the study of development in several ways. First, people are considered to be resources or even the seat of human capital. Secondly, it is the state of being, the standard of living, or even the quality of life that is the true measure of development. Thus, people are at the center of any analysis of development. One aspect of people's life is the liberty they enjoy and the rights they have to various dimensions of living. We explore the relation between the development and rights in a little later in this unit. The study of rights has traditionally linked to the concept of individual liberty. When it is said that someone has rights, it implies that she has a certain zone of liberty and privacy that no one has the authority to transgress or snatch away. At the societal level, this naturally gets modified into the concept of civil liberties. This implies that the state comes under scrutiny and is under observation as to whether it is providing rights to its citizen and moreover not violating their rights. Of course, one member of the society could infringe on the right of another, but then it is a matter of general law. Thus, social scientists have looked at human rights in terms of their being guaranteed and their possible violation by the state. Human rights are not merely matters of ethics. They primarily involve the obligation of the state. The success of human rights depends upon meeting of these obligations by the duty holders, namely the state. Human rights largely deal with the operation by the state. Human rights endow individuals with a legitimate claim against the state to enjoy an existential status with proper dignity. The primary thrust of human rights is on the empowerment of society, particularly the most vulnerable groups in society, to lay legitimate claims to the institutions of the state for a life with dignity and freedom and resources. Human rights are universal, indivisible, interdependent and interrelated. What is the relation between the ideas of human development and human rights? We may think that they deal with different areas of human existence. After all, it may seem that development is concerned with the standard of living and quality of life, while human rights are derived from notions of civil liberties and individual freedom. However, if we look carefully, we find that development can be defined as expansion of people's capability and opportunities and an increase in their freedom of choice to the lives they lead. Similarly, human rights are also not merely limited to civil liberties. Economic rights and right to development can be brought under this ambit. The role of the state goes beyond a protective one to a promotional one. Once it is realized that freedom does not simply mean freedom from something, but it also means opportunities, the focus of attention becomes the domain of opportunities that have to grow and development and to meet their needs and to realize their capabilities. This is a fruitful way to look at the concept of development in terms of opportunities, functioning and capabilities. As mentioned earlier, Amartya Sen has argued the adoption of a capability based as against a commodity-centered or even a utilitarian view of development. Looking at the concept of freedom in this manner, the notion of rights takes the form of right to something. Freedom is not just freedom from something. It can also mean freedom to do something or freedom to have access to something. This something in our case is basic human needs. Now, along with operation, deprivation, or rather its lack, has also been made a part of the concept of human rights. This is what we meant in the previous paragraph by saying that the role of the state has expanded from a mere protective one to promotional one. This is especially true in the case of economic rights. Here, deprivation can be used in two senses. First, some individuals may be deprived of something, may lack something all throughout. Secondly, individuals may have had these things but have had these snatched away, taken away through exploitation or aggression. In this latter sense, deprivation becomes a part of operation. In the first sense of deprivation that we have used, in which individuals have never had the things or items germane to our discussion, where there has been a constant lack, there can be reasons other than operation for this deprivation. The people may simply be very poor, for instance. If the full potential of a person is not allowed to blossom, If the person fails to realize her talent, latent capabilities, it is deprivation in the sense of not being allowed entitlements or optimal human potential. With regard to oppression, the idea of human rights seeks to determine minimum levels or thresholds, so that if people are pushed below these levels, we can say that oppression and hence human rights violation has taken place. How can these minimum threshold levels be determined? These thresholds can be determined by invoking the three principles of security, identity and participation. Security means personal security and access to a secure livelihood and a claim to privacy. Identity implies one's cultural and social identity too is protected, and participation involves being allowed to participate in the economic and political life of one's community, society or state. We study the concept of security in greater details in the next section. The approach based on rights goes further than the basic needs approach in the sense that it injects an element of accountability to the whole process. The government is held to be responsible for providing and promoting the rights of people to these basic needs, as well as ensuring that these rights are not infringed upon. In the subsequent sections, we spell what all this implies and entails. Like other human, economic rights are expressions of human dignity, which are common to all of humanity. Since we should look at all aspects of rights in totality, the approach to economic rights should be no different from that to other rights. As mentioned above, we should not equate economic rights simply with the basic needs approach, which is a mere statement of policy and involves some welfare measures by the state. Focusing on economic rights involves going beyond some enriched ideas of development, since that term, if interpreted in a particular way, can lead thousands of people to sorry plight. Through disenfranchisement, dislocation and deprivation, the development process has in some cases lead to overconsumption of exhaustible resources, devastation of nature and dislocation of marginal people. It has led to disparity in the standards of living of the countries of the north and those of the south and within countries, especially of the south. Hence, we have been careful to discuss the appropriate notion of development earlier in this section. It is partly to address these issues that the concept of sustainable development was developed. But the concept of economic rights goes beyond this as well. Its aim is to help create an international political and legal framework to ensure that the path of sustainable development is followed and basic needs are met. A basic point about economic rights need to be always kept in mind. Normally, while talking about rights in general, we speak of human rights violations. In other words, people have rights which are taken away. Here, the state should be in the dock. But in the case of economic rights, rights are in the sense of people being allowed to realize their capabilities. The state should ensure people's entitlement to various goods and services which meet the basic needs. The state should provide these goods and services. Here, the distinction between protective and promotional roles that we talked of earlier becomes important. A related point is that experiences of the operation of markets in various countries has shown that there are certain groups in society which are vulnerable to ill health, disease and general poverty and deprivation as the economy functions. In this regards, the state undertakes a certain set of functions that are described under the rubric of social security. We discuss these in the next section. Human security basic ideas. Let us first begin with the concept of social security. Security. We must have an idea of what exactly is meant by social security. What kind of services are provided? Who are the beneficiaries? Which are the institutions through which they are provided? And so on also. And this is very important. Why social security measures need to be provided? Let us take the last question first. Traditionally, in discussions on the subject, the term social security has been limited to mean the set of protective measures for workers in the organized industries or the whole organized sector, which do not let the earnings of the worker to suffer on account of being away from work. These measures include maternity leave, provident fund, and gratuity, and so on. But in recent times, it has been felt that since a small proportion of workers in developing nations are in the organized sectors, and since the poor and marginal face uncertain livelihood options and general vulnerability regarding income and consumption opportunities, it is pertinent to expand the scope of the concept of social security for a large number of people in developing nations, particularly for those in the rural areas and those who are poor. Deprivation and vulnerability are unpleasant facts of life. Many of the specific public actions to ameliorate deprivation and vulnerability can be considered part of the range of social security measures. In defining or explaining what social security is, one runs the danger of being too specific or too general. In developed countries, certain instruments have been found to be important, like unemployment insurance, old age pensions, and invalidity benefits. This approach may not be altogether useful and appropriate when we study developing countries. The other danger in explaining the concept of social security is to be too general. Instead of approaching the definition in terms of means, we could define social security in terms of objectives of removing deprivation and reducing vulnerability. Taking this approach, we could end up including anything that contributes towards these objectives as social security measures. That is part of the social security system. This approach would not take us very far because human well-being is affected by many social and economic factors, and not all of them are or can be included in the definition of social security. Social security is a set of basic public actions to reduce the vulnerability of affected people. Public action is not merely action by the state. It includes actions by the public for itself, during disasters, but also otherwise. The actions of NGOs, charitable and religious institutions must be mentioned here. In many traditional societies in India, the family too has acted as a provider of social security. Sometimes it can be taken to mean the checks and pressures that, say, the print media keeps on the government. Involvement and activism by the public is necessary. The public must act as a watchdog. Governments can adopt two broad approaches to social security measures. The first way is to promote general economic growth and use the general benefits accruing from growth to help vulnerable sections of the population. The second approach is to take public action measures directly in terms of social sectors such as education and health, and also promote better income distribution patterns and generate employment. It is possible to argue that checking inflation also helps in mitigating adverse effects of prices on the vulnerable sections of the population. The first approach seems to have worked very well for East Asian countries like Hong Kong, Singapore, Japan, South Korea, as also for countries like Kuwait and United Arab Emirates. Cuba is a classic example of second approach, as is China. In fact, some observers argue that in China, when liberalization led to very high growth rates in the 80s and 90s, social indicators like the infant mortality rate actually rose. It is not true that the former approach necessarily means relying on and encouraging the private sector, while direct public action implies a big role of the government. India is a case in point. In the 1950s, India chose a path of development that emphasized economic growth but relied on public sector as the engine of growth and let this sector occupy the commanding heights of the economy. This measure assumed that growth would automatically trickle down after a change of policy in the 70s when more weight was put behind the second kind of approach. India seems to have gone back to a growth-oriented strategy, but this time relying much more on the private sector and foreign capital and technology. Now we come to the discussion of the concept of human security. Since the Cold World War ended, the world has seen rapid globalization of human and economic activities, along with the liberalization of trade and investment and the marked progress of information technology. While globalization has provided substantial benefits, including the growth of the world economy and improvements in the standard of living, such benefits have not necessarily gone equally to all the countries and people in the world. Many problems like smuggling of arms, spread of infectious disease, global warming, etc. have become transnational because of globalization. After the end of Cold War, we have witnessed at several places a change in the nature of conflict, with ethnic and religious conflicts increasing, with some instances of civil war. Because of these changes, it is becoming necessary to come up with a new concept of security that addresses people's vulnerability to these types of conflict, which threaten their lives and livelihood. A concept that goes beyond national security that is largely provided by the state. One closer review, threats to human security are characterized as being both the cause and result of processes of disintegration of society and of state institutions. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, adopted by the UN in 1948, states that everyone has the right to life, liberty, and the security of person. However, the concept of human security now encompasses economic health and environmental concerns as well. The specific phrase human security was first put forward by the 1994 United Nations Development Programme Annual Human Development Report, while the term human security is of recent origin. The ideas that underlie the concept are not new. These ideas have been around ever since the International Red Cross was founded in the 1860s. It was there in the UN Charter and it was echoed in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. According to Article 3 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the right to security of persons is a fundamental human right. Together with the right to life and liberty, human liberty. Human security emphasizes the need to strengthen empowerment of the citizens. Achievement of human security requires a global political culture that is founded on shared values of human dignity and human rights. Hence, important issues in human security like children in war, landmine, and ethnic conflicts should be discussed from a broad human rights perspective. In essence, human security means freedom from pervasive threats to people's rights, their safety, or even their lives. Freedom from fear and freedom from want have become the phrases in vogue under the human security approach. It was not fully realized how interrelated both truly are. Furthermore, in ensuring human rights implies ensuring security. Human security, as defined in the UNDP report, consisted of 7 components and dimensions: economic, food, health, environmental, personal, community, and political. The main contribution of the UNDP's conception of human security was focusing on people's highlighting of vulnerability to threats other than violence. It saw security as an integrative rather than defensive concept, but it seemed to underplay threats from violence. It emphasized that human security has a geographical and even international dimension. Problems of international terrorism, drug trafficking, as well as problems of international migrants spill over outside the boundaries of the nation state. Democracy and good governance are very important in promoting human security. Human security does not supplant national security. A human security perspective asserts that the security of the state is not an end in itself. Rather, it is a means of ensuring security for its people. In this context, state security and human security are mutually supportive. Building an effective democratic state that values its own people and protects minorities is a central strategy for promoting human security. The term human security recognizes the linkages between environment and society. It also recognizes 2 other features of the link between environment and security. First, that feedback exists between environment and security. For example, environmental degradation may result in population movement, which in turn poses a threat to the environment. The Human Development Approach and the development of the Human Development Index was a major step forward in reorienting development for improvements in the lives of people and not merely economic growth. Human development is expansionist in nature and deals with increasing social services along with economic development to increase opportunities. However, this concept does not offer solution to deal with the downside. It does not effectively deal with measurement and analysis of situations where freedoms are curtailed and there is deterioration in the quality of lives of people. Human security provides an enabling environment of human development, where violence or the threat of violence makes meaningful progress on the development agenda impossible. Enhancing safety for people is prerequisite. Civil wars and riots depict such situations. Promoting human development can also be an important strategy for furthering human security by addressing inequalities that are often the root causes of violent conflict. Strengthening governance structures, complementing political, economic, and legal initiatives can enhance human security. We have highlighted this in unit 16 of this course. Health and food security. We have seen that human security comprises several aspects. In this section, we take up, for purposes of illustration, two basic components of human security, namely food and health security. The two concepts are interrelated in that nutritional status as a basic determinant of health status. However, we can discuss the two components separately. We begin with a discussion of health security. Health security means having low exposure to diseases and high and proper access to health services. Poor people are vulnerable to diseases as they live in degraded areas and have poor access to health services, or cannot afford medical care. For example, diarrhea because of poor water and sanitation services is a major cause of death among children. Malaria and tuberculosis are other diseases that are widespread. In recent years, the threat of AIDS has gone up tremendously and is affecting large sections of population. For health security, preventive strategies are very important and are closely related to provision of basic services of water supply, sanitation, and education. Of course, curative services and access to them, as well as their utilization, are crucial too. Health is an era where public action acquires them tremendous significance. We mentioned earlier that public action is not limited to action by the state and includes actions by non-government organizations and voluntary organizations. These organizations, other than government departments, are quite active in the health field in developing nations like India. Their efforts have been remarkable in combating and building awareness about deadly diseases like AIDS and in the ongoing Pulse Polio program in India to administer oral drops to children below 5 years of age to prevent polio. Now, let us discuss food security is a flexible concept. Many definitions of this concept have been attempted. The continuing evolution of concept of food security has reflected the wider recognition that the technical and policy issues are highly complex. A careful definition was that negotiated in the process of international consultation leading to the World Food Summit in November 1996. Food security as a concept originating in the mid-1970s in the discussions of international food problems when the world faced a global food crisis. The initial focus of attention was primarily on problems of food supply, of ensuring the availability and the price stability of basic food items at the national and international levels. A process of international negotiation followed, which led to the World Food Conference of 1974 and set of arrangements for promoting food security. The issues of famine, hunger, and food crisis were also being extensively examined. Following the events of mid-1970s, the outcome was a redefinition of food security, that the potential vulnerability of affected people is a critical aspect was explicitly recognized. Another factor which led to the modification of the views about food security was the emerging evidence that the technical successes of Green Revolution did not automatically lead to rapid and dramatic reductions in poverty and malnutrition. These problems were recognized as the result of lack of effective demand for the poor. Food security was defined in 1974. World Food Summit as Availability to all times of adequate world food supplies of basic foodstuffs to sustain a steady expansion of food consumption and to offset functions in production and prices. In 1983, Food and Agricultural Organization FAO expanded its concept to include securing access by vulnerable people to available supplies, implying that attention should be given to both the demand and supply side of the food security equation. Ensuring that all people at all times have been physical and economic access to the basic food that they need. The World Bank report Poverty and Hunger 1986 focused on the time dimensions food insecurity. It produced the widely accepted distinction between chronic food insecurity associated with problems of continuing or structural poverty and low incomes, and transitory or temporary food insecurity, which involved period of intensified pressure caused by natural disaster, economic collapse, or conflict. This concept of food security is further elaborated in terms of access of all people at all times to enough food for an active, healthy life. All the times. All this time, attention was focused on protein, calorie, malnutrition. By the 1990s, it was recognized that food preferences could be socially or culturally determined. The 1996 World Food Summit adopted a still more complex definition. Food security at the individual, household, national, regional, and global levels. When all people at all times have physical and economic access to sufficient, safe, and nutritious food to meet their dietary needs and food preferences for an active and healthy life. The definition is again refined in the State of Food Insecurity 2001. Food security is a situation that exists when all people at all times have physical, social, and economic access to sufficient, safe, and nutritious food that meets their dietary needs and food preferences for an active and healthy life. Essentially, food security can be described as a phenomenon relating to individuals. It is the nutritional status of the individual household member that is the ultimate focus, and the risk of that adequate status not being achieved or becoming undermined. The latter risk describes the vulnerability of individuals in this context. As the definitions reviewed above imply, vulnerability may occur both as chronic and transitory phenomenon. Food security is a multidimensional phenomenon. National and international efforts are needed to meet and ensure food security, especially in the era of globalization and liberalization. Attention has to be given to long-run food security, and focus should be limited to transitory food insecurity. Summary. In this unit, we discussed several notions related to human lives and livelihoods and their security. We began with the concept of human development. We saw how development is being from growth and how human development is distinct from the concept of human capital and human resource development. We proceeded to examine the concept of human rights and how it is derived from civil liberties. As the unit brought out, individual and human rights imply a focus on the agency of the state. The state's promotional and protective actions need to be scrutinized. Drawing from these concepts, we discussed the meaning of social security. We saw it implies protection of the vulnerable, who often are the poor and marginalized, from sudden losses in livelihood options. Social security can be protected and enhanced by proper public action and effective roles of NGOs. From this idea of security, we proceeded to a discussion of human security. Threats and transnational as well as intranational. Moreover, security has come to mean freedom from fear as well as freedom from want. The UNDP, in the course of bringing out its human development report, crystallized the concept of human security and brought out its precise meaning. In this unit, we elaborated on this concept, discussed its meaning, and saw how it is related to human development and human rights. We ended the unit with a discussion of two basic components of human security, namely health and food security.